Hey guys, Daniel here.
This is another video. My next guest needs no introduction. It's the legendary Peter McKenna. He's a writer and he's also the showrunner on the hit new Kin TV show, which has been fantastic. You can check it out on RTE or AMC. Basically, it's a show about a Dublin family which are embroiled in a gang war. We'll be discussing that in detail. But he's also gotten to work on other shows such as Red Rock, Eastenders, Hobley City, Casualty, and so much more. But Peter has very kindly agreed to come on for an interview and let me annoy him. But Peter, thank you so much for coming on. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great, and thanks for having me, Daniel. It's a real honor to be on your YouTube channel.
Well, thank you so much. Normally, whenever I'm interviewing someone, they're always from America or England, and they're always like, oh yeah, the weather's brilliant, it's so sunny here. But you're in Ireland as well, so we can both lie and just say it's beautiful outside when we both know it's dark and rainy.
So, well, it is raining. Are you in Dublin?
Yes, of course. And that's why it's always dark and rainy. I've been told they call it an emerald isle for the reason. But, you know, alas, we have to make do with what we have. So I imagine it's very sunny over there in Kilkenny.
Yeah, well, the sunny side east, it is kind of grey and wet now as well. Although I was in Dublin today, and when I was driving home, it was kind of rainy in Dublin and Kildare. And as I got to Kilkenny, it was bright. But I think that the rain's caught up with me now. But yeah, it's dark and wet. Yeah.
Right. And what better way to let me annoy you on a dark and rainy day? Your day can only, you've kind of hit rock bottom, so it can only get worse from now. So, I mean, we have that going for us. Yeah, so absolutely, so many different things to discuss. But my first question for you is, how did you get into writing? So were you an avid writer growing up, or?
Well, actually, it was the opposite. I was an avid reader, and I love TV, and I love movies. And I went to boarding school quite young at the time. My parents were working abroad. So when I was seven, I went to boarding school. So I would have spent a long time on my own and in my own company. And I would have, like, there was no, I'm going to sound ancient now, but there was no internet. There wasn't loads of TV channels. There was what? None of that.
And you had a pet dinosaur back then?
Well, almost. We used in the boarding school on a Sunday night, they would put on a movie on a projector. And we would wait for the nuns to come back from Dublin with the reels of tape to see what movie she had got. And we would pull the doors open. There was sliding doors between classrooms, and they'd set it up like a little mini cinema. And that was the only time we watched TV or anything in the whole week. Like, it was a Sunday night movie. And I remember watching movies like, you know, Digby, Biggest Dog in the World, and stuff like that. They were all quite harmless. But to go back to your question, I never really wrote anything. I was very bad at school. So I think it was because I had a very unsettled, like, I was in boarding school from 7 to 16. I kind of fell behind early on. I missed a year. My parents were in Africa. I missed a year of schooling, and I never really caught up, and I wasn't very diligent, or I wasn't very hardworking. So to kind of, I suppose, to get me through a lot of that time, I would read books, watch movies. Like, I'd read anything. My parents had loads of books of all kinds of things. I would just read anything from, like, pulp fiction kind of thrillers to inappropriate adult novels to anything at all. And I think I just love stories. And when I was a teenager, like my early teens, I kind of thought, like, I want to make movies, I want to make TV. But there was nothing in my life or abilities that would give you any indication. No teacher ever said to me, like, you're good, you should do this. In fact, the opposite. You know, there was no encouragement. I knew nobody I knew nobody was a writer. I remember talking to my parents about when I was leaving school, saying I wanted to be a journalist, because it felt like I didn't know how to become a writer, and a journalist felt much more kind of achievable. And they were just poo-pooing it. They were going, there's no money in journalism. So I didn't start really writing until my late 20s, although all the time I wanted to be a writer, and I would think, I'm going to be a writer, but I never did anything. So, like, there's hope for everybody. Yeah.
Yeah, brilliant. You just put it perfectly there. But you know, your new show, Kin, which has been fantastic. I know I love it. But for anyone watching who's not aware of the concept, what can you tell us about Kin?
Kin is like a Dublin set crime show, and it's about a Dublin family who are involved in crime, and they get involved in a gangland war with a much bigger international cartel. And it really studies this family, the relationships within the family, and the pressures on those relationships. And it does it within a kind of like a gangster genre. So we use the kind of like the tropes of a gangster genre to put the pressure on the characters and explore the relationships within the show. So that's the ambition of the show, I guess.
Yeah, definitely. And so did you pitch this to RTE? Did you pitch the show? How did the show even come about? Did you just come up with the idea and pitch it to them, or?
No, it was kind of, there was a show being developed by Braun, which are an American studio, and they kind of make Joker, Morning Show, Euphoria. Like, if you go and Google Braun, you'll see what they've made, amazing stuff. And they were getting into TV, and myself and an Irish director called Kieran Donnelly and a few other people were coming up with ideas and working in a writer's room. And that was a long process, and we went through different ideas that didn't quite work. And then before we came to Kin and the idea of Kin, RTE came on very early as well. They were very involved, and Braun were the producers. Like, they produced this American studio, and we knew we were going to be in RTE. And then we began to sell it before it was finished to other things like AMC in America, the platform to make like Mad Men and Breaking Bad and The Walking Dead. And via play in Northern Europe, and we're still selling the show to various different territories at the moment. But yeah, it was a long process. I suppose it really began in about 2017, and now it's 2021. So about 3 or 4 years of development and writing and getting ready. So
brilliant. And I know another question I want to ask you. George Lucas himself, director of Star Wars, he said that, you know, despite all this sci-fi action, Star Wars at its core is a family tale. And I kind of, would you consider that the same for Kin? Because we can see, despite all this action, at the core of the heart of the show, it's basically just a show about family, which I think is what is probably why it appeals to so much people. But do you think that as core, Kin is a show about family?
Absolutely, 100%. And like, so many of my favorite shows are about family. Like, even at the moment, we're waiting for the third season of Succession to come out, which is a family show. Like The Crown, Peaky Blinders, The Sopranos, like a lot of these, like a lot of the shows you really love are basically family shows. And then other shows like, say, Mad Men, which is a show I really like, is kind of like, it's not about a literal family, but the people within the agency are like a family. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you can see that in the way they present it. So I think a family is a brilliant kind of construct in drama to explore ideas and relationships and all that. So absolutely, you're 100% right. When we talk about Kin, we talk about it first as a family drama that happens to be set in a gangland setting. That's really what it is.
Yeah, definitely. So is it difficult to like kind of blend those two aspects of having enough action and then also having, you know, enough family moments? Was that difficult for you, or did you catch that, you know, the hang of it very quickly?
Well, I think it is difficult because I think like there's a danger with two different genres. And like, what's interesting is some people find Kin slow, and that's because we're dealing with family stuff, yeah, and there isn't enough gangland. And it is a balance, because like the gangland stuff is often action, and that's what brings people in, and there's shootings and fightings and, you know, robberies or whatever it is, and that's the kind of like the kind of high octane action of a gangster show. And but if you do that all the time, then you don't give yourself enough time to explore character, and it's getting that balance right. And like, you know, I'm not going to sit here and say we got that balance right all the time. We often, if we were leaning in one direction, we kind of lean towards the family, which some people really like. And some people like that it's exploring family and emotion. But other people find it slow. Other people are going kind of, where's the shootings? Oh, my God, this is so slow. And that's because we're exploring family relationships. And probably because when they sit down to watch Kin, they're sitting down going, I'm going to watch a gangster show. And then they're looking at this family who are grieving about the death of a son. And they're going, okay, yeah, but where's the shootings? And I kind of get that they're kind of like, I understand their response. But Kin is what it is. And like all shows, like, you're not going to make something that everybody likes. So you have to make the show you want to make and hope that people like it, or enough people like it. So that's where we are.
Well, I mean, that's on you. For every 2 minutes, there just should have been some shooting for no reason. Just every 2 minutes of every episode, someone gets shot. You don't really explain why. Just red shirts in Star Trek. Like, you just make very specific characters just for them to be shot. Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think I recently asked a writer who obviously wrote a lot of anti-heroes, and I guess the show is kind of with those type of characters. So is your goal to make... Because, I mean, there are some really great characters in the kinsella family. Like, you know, I'm not sure if I pronounced it right, but, you know, some of them, as great as they are, they also get up to some, you know, dodgy behavior, I suppose. And so, you know, is it important for you to make these characters likable, or are you just trying to make them understandable?
Yeah, no, definitely not likable. I don't think that's not really my job in a way. And I don't think it's, like, important either. And I don't think when I look at, like, back over all the TV characters I really love, that many of them are particularly likable. Like, the ones that really intrigue me, and I mentioned Succession, I don't think he's a likable character in Succession, and it's my favorite TV show at the moment. Like, you know, and I'm not comparing all these shows to Kin, by the way. I'm just picking shows I like, but like Don Draper or Tony Soprano or Walter White. Like, most of these characters aren't what you would say are likable, but yeah, what they are is interesting. And again, like, what we're trying to do in this, in the show, is make the motivations of the characters believable within the world they live. They mightn't be the choices you'd make in those situations, but these people live in the world, and this is this. What I don't want is you to look at it and go, I just don't believe that. I don't believe that character would do that thing. And that's what worries me more. But whether you like them or not, no, I think it's more important that you're interested in them and you want to know what happens next in their lives. So, and you know, some characters, and there's a range of characters within the show, because there's some characters that you might find likable, and then there's others that are just like certainly Viking in the beginning is quite annoying.
Yeah.
And like, I can see why people might go, I just don't like him at all. But that doesn't mean, and I find, and I think as the show goes on, you'll find this, it doesn't mean you don't want to watch what he does. Like, often people who are unlikable are quite compelling. So, you know, no, not likable. That doesn't concern me at all. You know?
Yeah, definitely. And you put perfectly there. Like, and I love how some of the characters kind of like towing that line. Like Jimmy, one of my favorite characters in the show. Like, we can see, you know, I mean, he probably just put like an iron into someone's face, but then the next episode he's grieving, and we can understand that aspect of him, and we can still understand why they're doing these things. And I think, you know, the cast is brilliant and they all portray that perfectly. But I think, you know, it all kind of, it's a kind of like a balancing act. And is that a lot of Kin for you, a balancing act?
It is a balancing act, and it's kind of like, it's really interesting to say Jimmy and the scene with the iron, because in the very next scene he sits in the car with his son and he goes, I love you, don't waste your sympathy on drug addicts. And the very last thing he says to his son is, put your seatbelt on. So he's like a father. The same thing, and it is funny, like, not many actors came to me and said, look, why do I want to do this? But one scene that, like, I was worried about, and I know I discussed it with Claire Dunn, who plays Amanda. There was one scene where I was thinking, is this too much? Like, am I, and we had a chat about it. And what I really felt was, there's a scene at the beginning of episode 3, where at the very beginning, where she sits in the morning of her son's funeral, and she says to Jimmy, I want Michael to say the eulogy.
Yes.
And that's quite a like a harsh thing, a mean thing to do to her husband, who's been very supportive of her and whatever. And we spoke about this, you know, like, and it wasn't about being likable, but it was just, is this too much? And what we decided, myself and Claire, after discussing it, is that, like, it's emotionally truthful. We had played out her grief and how she was doing things that are slightly out of character, like the car crash, like things like this, that she's acting out her grief. And this is another step in this process of acting in her grief. It doesn't make her likable. Like, people aren't going to tune in and watch her do that and go, I love this woman. She's, you know, it's actually, and it's quite a brave thing for an actor to play that kind of thing, where they know what they're doing will make their character unlikable in a way, in many people's eyes. But we felt it was true to Amanda, her character and her situation, and we went with it. So that was one of the few times in the whole first series that I had a conversation going, is this too much? Are we, you know, are we pushing it too much? Are we just, you know, being, you know, provocative in an untruthful way?
Yeah. The problem was, there wasn't enough shooting in that scene. That's just it. Like, man should just pull out a pistol for no reason, just start firing.
Yeah. Just, well, or he should have. He should have, like,
yeah, Mexican standoff.
Looking for Michael with a gun. So I don't know. Yeah.
Can't spoil the series so far, because I assume this is definitely going to happen next episode, because I brought it up now. 100% has to happen. But like I said, like, obviously with character work, I love how you've been exploring each character. Like, even Eamon Cunningham, for those who don't know, he's kind of the villain of the series so far. But we can see that someone close to him was diagnosed with kind of an incurable illness. And you can see that side of him that's like, you know, we do see it does have a heart somewhere buried deep inside there. So it's important for you to give each of these characters, you know, at least their reasons or their meaning. Because, like, before that, I didn't even pay Eamon Cunningham. Like, I didn't think of him, like, his character, just have him as that villain. But after that, I'm seeing, you know, there's maybe a few sides to these characters. So is that important for you to show, like...
It was really important, in particular, with Eamon Cunningham and with Kieran Hines. Like, Kieran Hines is an actor probably I would have grown up, like, really admiring. Like, you know, one of my favorite Irish actors. I love the work. So then to get to a position where you're actually writing for this person, because he came on quite early. So, like, I was still writing, like, I had half written the show when I knew that I knew that, like, Kieran was going to be in it.
Wow.
So by the time I probably got to episode 4, And that scene with his wife was not in the first few drafts of episode three. But by the time I got to there, I began to think, like, you know, every episode, I'm kind of writing him the same scene. He's just been a baddie. And, like, it's hard because, like, there's so many kinsellas and you just don't have the time to give everybody as much character development. But still, I have this amazing actor that I really love. I may never get to work with him again, and it's a real kind of honor for me. So I should do more. Like, I'm shortchanging him, and I'm shortchanging myself. So we went back, and, like, without giving anything away, there is an episode coming up in the next few episodes where you get a lot more of Eamon Cunningham, and you actually get a story from his point of view that isn't just about him killing kinsellas. So, and we really worked on that. And to make him, like, to make him sympathetic. Like, we wanted a baddie that wasn't just a terrible baddie, that, like, actually you begin to feel a bit for him as the show goes on. So you're kind of torn between your feelings for the kinsellas and him a little bit. But yeah, absolutely. And this is the problem, you know, or the challenge with a show like this is we have so many great actors. Like, you know, we have such a brilliant cast. Like characters like Maria Doyle Kennedy, who plays Birdie, Sam Keeley, who plays Viking, like Yasmin Seki, her first time ever acting, who plays Nikita. You want to give them more. You want to give, but the pie is only so big. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And, like, once you cut a slice for somebody, you're taking pie away from somebody else. So it's hard to get the balance right, but it was real. I was really conscious. I had all these brilliant actors and to make sure I give them all something. And Eamon Cunningham was definitely one I was, you know, and Kieran Hines, I was determined to kind of try and give them more story within the confines of the show we had.
Yeah, definitely. And so, like, there's a great cast of characters, not only just the kinsellas, like, we see all these other brilliant characters. So was there one character in particular that you didn't expect to be so much fun writing for, besides Fudge, of course, who would just be the one, just because he has an amazing name, and writing Fudge over and over would just be brilliant. If you haven't noticed, I like Fudge as a character, you know, I'm very shy about it, but I just heard that. But yeah, no, did you notice that there was any character that you didn't expect to like writing so much that you'd ended up loving writing for?
Well, honestly, Birdie would be the main one.
Yeah.
And I think Viking, like in the early things, Viking was a bit of a, and he can be a bit of a knucklehead, but like, I think what both Sam Keeley and Maria Doyle Kennedy bring to the characters changed the way I saw the character. And particularly like Sam is like, the character he's playing is the character was on the page, but he brings an extra dimension with his presence and all that. With Birdie had started out as like almost like Frank's mother, so the grandmother kind of. So she was a woman in her 70s and she was like this like Irish matriarch. But then we had kind of COVID and it became very, very hard to cast people of that age because of like insurance and all this kind of we were trying to shoot. So that became really, really difficult shooting in like a pandemic and a lockdown. So we changed the character and made her younger. And we looked at a few different people because like Maria wasn't available at the beginning. She was one of the people we discussed, but she had other commitments. And we looked at different characters and they made our different actors and they made me look at the character in different ways. One or two would wanted to do it, but they had other commitments they couldn't get out of, or they were not they couldn't get out, but that they had other commitments. So for that, but each time I'd look at an actor for the part of Birdie, she would make me think of the character slightly different. So the character kind of became vague then, like in a funny way, because it was a mix of like, it was once a granny, then it was this person, then it was this person. And it was kind of a bit kind of vague. And there's a little bit of that in the early episodes, you know, with Birdie, like Birdie still is kind of in the background, but she does come forward a bit more as we go along. And once you begin to see somebody like, you know, Maria Doyle Kennedy playing the part, and like Maria did so much work, put so much into it, and really kind of helped bring the character alive. But then I began to look at Rushes, where we'd see the stuff we'd shot the day after. And then I go, oh my God, that's who Birdie is. So in a way, Maria kind of unlocked it and she made it fun then to write this kind of, this character. But as I said, the challenge in this show always was like, I have like Amanda, Jimmy, Michael, Frank, Viking, Birdie, you know, Kieran, Eamon Cunningham. So I have all these different characters, you know, to give time to. And even in the first episode, the character of Jamie gets quite a lot of screen time. So it's just, how do we give everybody enough? And that was the challenge. But certainly Birdie was one that probably when I was writing in the beginning, I didn't have the same love for it until I saw Maria playing the part. She was brilliant.
Yeah. Definitely. And so would you consider, does Kin have any main characters, like maybe Amanda and Michael, or is it just like the cast characters and they're all kind of main characters? Do you consider it to have a main character or no?
I would probably consider it. I would consider it an ensemble. So that, like, we do get story, but like, you know, the truth is the main characters are Michael and Amanda, really, and in different ways. Like, Michael has quite a, like, and Charlie has quite a difficult task as an actor to play the part of Michael, because Michael's quite an internal character.
Yeah.
And he's quite, almost, he's reluctant to take action. He's very kind of, so that for an actor is hard. And as a writer, it's hard, because you don't want to make this character really boring. And then the character of Amanda, it kind of drives the show from after the death of her son. The choices she makes drive the show forward. And she's a much more propulsive character. And what was interesting about her is that she's not born into this world. Like, this world is not her world. Like, she's married into it. So she is more journey to travel, if you know what I mean. As a character, yeah. I can start her off as somebody who's slightly in denial, who's kind of going, you know, to her son, like, what I do is different. And she's this woman who's married in, but is kind of in denial, who just wants her kids to go to college and become like lawyers and doctors and do a good job and be respectable. And then this terrible thing happens in her life and it begins to change her and she goes in a certain direction. So that gave me a lot more kind of road to travel than some of the Kinsellas who are already in this world and know the world and they're part of it. So, like, yeah. I would probably say Amanda and Michael are the main characters, but it's a subtle kind of main characters, because, you know, we give a lot of time to everybody, and I would see it as an ensemble.
Yeah, definitely. And so can we expect more of Amanda? Because we know, like, now she's kind of, you know, getting more involved in this type of crime family. So without spoilers, will we maybe see more of her?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Can't wait for that. And so another character I love you've been exploring is Michael. Because, you know, and you can see that he's kind of being dragged down by the actions of his family. You know, he's meant to stay clean. He wants to, you know, become in contact with his daughter again. But that's maybe not something that's really in the realm of possibility. And we can really see that he's kind of being dragged down by his family. So is that interesting for you to write? And also one scene in particular, which I really love, probably my favorite scene in Hold the Show, or definitely one of them, was the scene at the church, you know, between Anna and Michael, because that was like when we can actually see, like, Michael really vulnerable and raw there. So is that aspect of Michael fun for you to write?
Yeah, I don't know if it's fun. It's important that I think we put it in. I think it's hard for me to write. Like, to be honest, like, there's some stuff that are fun. There's scenes that are fun and parts of it that I, you know, that I really enjoyed writing. I find the Michael and Anna stuff, it probably takes more work for me, because it's kind of, I don't know if it's more subtle, but it's just, as a writer, you're trying to dig into emotions a lot more. You're trying to kind of, and you're doing it with a character who doesn't display emotions. Like, he's a very closed off character. He's a very kind of, like, you know, introverted character, and like, you know, closed is the word. Like,
yeah.
We would always talked about, like, he had grown up with a lot of trauma. And that's there with him all the time. And what's really interesting, and it's funny you should pick that as your favorite scene, when we were sending out scripts at the beginning, before we shot anything, we'd send it to people who ended up working on the show and all that. And we talked to them when we were talking through the job. And a lot of them said, after the first four or five scripts, they go, I really feel for Michael. And you're kind of going, and some of them would say, Amanda's a hard ass, like in almost a slightly negative way.
Yeah.
And you're kind of going, Amanda has lost a child and she's gone through an awful grief, and she's doing something that, like, kind of most people in their minds would think, you know, if this happened to my son, I would go and get revenge or whatever. So she's doing something, but yet people were not as kind of, they were going, she's a hard ass. Michael, who got out of jail for killing his ex, we know he's involved in crime all his life. We see him shoot somebody in the bar. Like, we see all these things, and all of them are going, I feel for him. And I think that's about vulnerability. And I think Michael is closed as a character, but especially in Charlie's performance, then brought it up a notch again, is he's quite a vulnerable character. Like, he feels vulnerable. And as he said, and a lot of them felt what you felt, is like, this is a guy who wants to be good, but this family are just dragging him back into their shit all the time. And he can't get away from it. He's trying to do the right thing, but he's torn between, like, the right thing and the loyalty he feels to this family, who, you know, so he is an interesting character, you know, so, Sorry, what was the question again? Oh yeah, is it hard? It's harder to write. It takes longer for me to write those scenes and that storyline across the thing. But I think there's something interesting about it. And I think there's something quite compelling about the way Charlie plays Michael. Like, he brings like real emotion to the character.
Yeah, and I think the thing about Michael is that, you know, I'm coming back to this word anti-hero. He's not necessarily something like that, but he's kind of crossing that line sometimes or bordering it. And you always see, you know, anti-heroes, they always kind of push to one side. Like, they don't do that unspeakable act and then that pushes them completely to one side. I mean, it's their redemption's finished. So I think, you know, Michael's really interesting because he hasn't done something that's so despicable yet. So we still kind of continue to like him because we can understand, like, so far everything he's done has kind of been justifiable, or we can understand why he did it. Like, you know, he's not shooting people for kicks or anything like that. So I thought that's really interesting there, which you just put perfectly. But yeah, AMC also has parent this, and they're showing it to American audiences. So did you know from the very start that this show would also be showed in America and Ireland?
Well, I did. I knew that the ambition was. We were being made by an American company, a studio, Bronze Studios. And for they couldn't just make a show that existed in Ireland. That just didn't make it feasible for them. So they needed to make a show that would travel and would sell, you know, in America and other territories around the world. So they wanted to make that. I didn't know it would be AMC when we were starting out, but I did know the ambition was to make a show that would play in America.
Yeah, definitely. And so, like I said, have you noticed, because this is of course being shown to American audiences, so did you have to kind of change something? Because as great as it is to have these little Irish ideologies, like, you know, what's the crack and stuff, and like all these little sayings, maybe someone in America would be sitting here watching, like, you know, what's he saying there? What does this mean? What does this word mean? And so did you have to change anything, or were they very, like, pretty lenient with how the script was?
Really lenient. They didn't really make us change much at all. What they did do a few times is when we speak as Irish people, we speak really quickly and we roll our words into one. So like if you were trying to what you're saying, what I'm saying is there would be kind of like a word, a gap. That's how you'd write it. But then when we speak it, we run all the words as one. And we speak really quickly. And I think at times the Americans struggled with that a little bit. It was more the speed and the way we speak rather than what we were saying. So like there was one or two times where we did, like, we re-recorded an actor's dialogue to make it just a slightly bit clearer to the viewer, but they didn't come in saying, no, we want this or we want that.
Yeah,
they didn't want it to be kind of like a mid-Atlantic show, because I think they, you know, like, the shows that kind of do well have a very strong sense of place. And they're the shows, in like, if you watch all the shows you really like at the moment, I don't know what shows you're watching, but like, just big, like Mare, like there was a Mare of Eastenders that had a really strong sense of place at Breaking Bad, like all these shows do. And I think they kind of felt that, like, for to be an Irish show and a successful Irish show, it had to feel like Ireland. The people who were watching in America had to feel like they were getting a window into Ireland. And if we water it down and make it like kind of semi-American, that's not going to really work. So no, I didn't get any pressure at all, really, just to make people speak a bit clearer.
Yeah, absolutely. And so was there any trouble with Garda or cop, like Garda and cop? Because, you know,
it's funny you should pick on that. That was one of the few words that was Trump. And like, I probably changed a few of those to make it easier, to be honest. I wasn't under pressure of my, but it was one of the few ones where I kind of, that was one of the only words. It's funny you should pick up on that. It was one of the few words where it wasn't always clear. Do you know what I mean? But like, and I probably would have changed a few to make it a little bit clearer for Americans. But that's probably the only word. I can't think of a single other thing that I would have been conscious that wouldn't travel, because they, you know, and we do use a lot of Dublin slang and Dublin kind of vernacular.
Yeah.
And as you said, crack and stuff like that. And like, you know, but I got no notes to change anything. But like, they were very supportive. Like, they wanted to make an Irish show. It wasn't like, and they didn't want to make it like a diddly idly show. Like, they didn't want to do that. They didn't want what we think is an American version of Ireland. They just wanted to make a show that they thought was good, that was set in Ireland, you know, and represented Ireland.
Well, this may come as a shock, but almost everyone in the world is Irish, because their granddad's cousin had a bit of Irish in them. So therefore, vis-a-vis, they're Irish, you know, that's just how it works, you know, Irish ancestors. You know, I haven't heard that language, you know, nothing. But yeah, so I've interviewed many different like comic writers and writers who've set stories in Ireland. And do you think that your story being set in Ireland gives it a certain charm? Because like you said, like, it's kind of based on this one place, which is kind of what works in its favor. Do you think that maybe if you set this in some place in New York, it would have the same effect? Or do you think that's set in here in Dublin you know, made it more resonate with people more, or?
Well, I don't actually, in a funny way. I think by selling it in Ireland and filming in Ireland with Irish writer and Irish actors, I think it has a sense of identity. That if, you know, and if I wrote it, say if Dave said, look, the show, we like the scripts, but we want to film it in America, and we went and told that story in New York or somewhere else, we would have had to get like different casts, different things, and make sure that it felt specific to the place. And maybe even like an American writer to polish my dialogue to make sure it felt truthful of that place. But I don't think, because I don't think Kane is charming in a way. In some ways, I feel I've probably made it too much of a kind of like intense, emotional, you know, I don't know if I'm not sure I put enough crack into it, you know, so, but I do think, or I hope it has its own identity. And when we, you know, I suppose in some ways what we wanted to do as well was create something that didn't feel like other Irish films or shows you'd seen before, that we chose locations, we chose houses and places that weren't familiar. Yes. So that it would feel like a fresh world. And I think that's one of the great things about, like, you know, about casting Claire. Claire had just, her movie's out at the moment called Herself, which is brilliant. And I don't know if you've seen it. It's really, really good. And again, it's set in Dublin. It's a brilliant, brilliant film. But one of the things I really like about, like, casting Claire, on top of the fact that she's an amazing actor and she's brilliant to work with, is that, like, people don't have baggage with her. Like, they don't associate her with many other roles. And she feels fresh, and she feels, you know, truthful and authentic. And I think that as well helps to establish the identity of the show, that this is kind of like an Irish show that shows a part of Ireland we probably haven't seen before. And you were talking about anti-heroes. Like Michael to me is not really an anti-hero, but Amanda maybe. You know what I mean? So I think if you're looking for anti-heroes in the show, it could end up being Amanda. You know, she is the one. I do think Michael's almost on the opposite journey. He's a guy who's always trying to be good. Like he's not giving in to, like, he has to do stuff for his family, but his intentions are always good. I think her journey is slightly different, and she could end up being, who knows, if we get another season or two, she could end up being an anti-hero.
Yeah, definitely. And you just put perfectly there. But yeah, so the cast, of course, is amazing. And did you know from the very start that some actors would be attached to this project? Like, you know, Charlie Cox and the rest of the cast. Did you know from the very start that they would be attached? Or
no, we wrote the script. We knew nobody. We wrote the script. The first person who was attached was Kieran Hines. And that was kind of almost, you know, one of the executives in America said to me, look, this part here of Eamon Cunningham, you know, is there anybody you'd love in that part? And I said, yeah, look, an Irish actor I really love is Kieran Hines. And that executive got on a plane, went to London to see him in a play, met him backstage and spoke to him and kind of helped sell the show to him and the idea of the show. So getting Kieran was the first person. Then we began to look at different people for different parts. With Amanda, we looked at one or two actresses. Like, I didn't know about Claire at the time. One person we spoke to got offered a really big show in America then and took that. Another person we spoke to and who was keen to do it for personal reasons couldn't do it. And then was really keen, and we left on very good terms. It was just, like, you know, not unfortunate. It was just her personal life kind of got in the way, but something happened in her personal life to mean she was no longer available to do it. Like a good thing, not a bad thing. It's no tragedy. And then, so we'd spent a few months looking at different people. And Claire had been working in a writer's room in New York with Sharon Horgan. She wasn't even on lists with casting agents because she was writing. And then the pandemic came and she came home and we were suddenly looking for Amanda. And we'd cast Charlie at this stage. Charlie got cast because his wife is an executive in Braun. And she was reading the scripts and she worked on the show. And she said, like, she didn't give them to him to read for Michael. She just said, what do you think of these? I really like these. I'm going to work on this. And he was lined up to do something else. And he read them and he goes, I really love Michael. I think that's brilliant. And the other thing he was meant to do fell through. And then he came on board and he was brilliant. And, like, you know, took a big pay cut to come to Ireland, brought his whole family here in pandemic. Like a real commitment to the show, a huge commitment to come over, huge commitment to doing the language. So he was then on next. And then we were looking for Amanda. And the an agent sent us, contacted Louise Kiley, who's a brilliant casting director who had worked with me on Red Rock as well. And she's done Normal People. She's done Conversations with Friends. She's incredible. And she just said to myself and the executives in Braun, would you look at this film? Like this, the agent has put Claire Dunn in. She hasn't got lots of TV experience, but like, have a look at it. And I've been looking through loads of people, watching movies, looking. And at this stage, because we haven't found anyone, there was pressure on us a little bit to kind of maybe go and look and get an English actress, you know. But I was saying, we've already cast Charlie Cox, who isn't Irish. I want one of the two leads to be Irish. Like, so I was coming up, no, I want her to be Irish. I want this part. Like, there's so many talented Irish actors. You just feel like, you know, there is something, it's not that it's not right, but I just wanted it to go to an Irish actor. That's what it was. And then I got sent to herself, a link to herself, and I sat down on a Friday night with my wife and my daughter. My wife had, like, I'd show her everything and gone through the whole process with her. And we watched the movie, and it's a brilliant movie that Claire wrote and starred in. And at the end of the movie, Helen, my wife, said to me, that's her, you found her. And then she did tape, she auditioned for us, and it worked out well, and she was great. And like, now I can't imagine anyone else. It was just, I knew she was right. So then she was the next one. And then we began to cast outward. Then we cast, like, you know, Sam Keeley and Emma Scanlon. And, oh, yeah. and then because of the pandemic, people like Aidan Gillen, who was meant to be doing a play, became available. Maria became available. So it just began to flesh it out. Yeah. But that was probably the process, really, you know.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And here's an hypothetical for you. If you had to choose one character to give a spin-off show to, you could just write for this one specific character. Besides Fudge and Jimmy Snake, that's not a metaphor or an innuendo, he has a pet snake. Who's that one character you'd like to work on or give a spin-off show to?
Might be two. Because they're a pair. Yeah.
Fudge riding Jimmy Snake around? Oh, man. Is that
I would pick Viking and Nikita. Oh, yeah. I would give them, and again, they haven't had a ton yet. They get more as it goes on, but I think I would give them the if I had to think of like as I said, the Better Call Saul spin-off of Kim, yeah. I think it would be Viking and Nikita. They work brilliantly together. They get the better and better as the show goes on. They bring a different kind of energy as well. I'd give them the spin.
Obviously, after Fudge and Snake, then they kind of come in.
Well, yeah. Fudge now is, well, I'd have to do like a Fudge, what would it, an origin story or a prequel with Fudge, yeah, you know. how we got to this.
Fudge, the origin, Fudge begins, Fudge rises, yeah. Just a trilogy, we can bring it out. I've been wondering why RTE haven't been responding to my 800-page script about Fudge and Snake. What's that about? They must have broken emails, that must be the only thing. But another question I'll ask you, is probably head right now, how you want the series to end up?
Well, I've written, obviously, the series that we're shooting, that you're watching is shot. That's all done.
I thought you just streamed it live every week, just for that day when I was watching it.
The second series, I've written one script and I'm writing the second script, and I would have an idea of the plans for that.
So, yeah, definitely. And so even if this goes on for a while, do you have an ending in mind? Because I know a lot of writers, when they're first starting out something, they kind of know how they want it to end. So is that the same for you, Duke? Or is that a little bit, hopefully, far off for you to decide later?
Well, I had imagined three seasons for Amanda. That's so, like, and I kind of know where I'm going with that. That was my plan for it, to have it in that way. And at different stages and different things happen. And but, like, you know, I also don't want to overthink it, because a part of me is kind of like a bit superstitious. And I think, you know, by planning like way into the future, I'm just tempting the gods of TV to go, you're cancelled. So I'm really reluctant. I'd probably, my brain will go into more of an overdrive when I know we're doing it. At the moment, I'm writing the first two episodes of the second season. I'm going to see where that leaves us. I have plans, but, you know, until I get a green light, there's no point in getting too stuck into it.
Yeah, brilliant, definitely. And so before we finish up, my last and final question, because it took them so much time, do you notice like freedom working on King? Because like I said, these are your own characters, you've created them, they're all, or co-created them, they're all kind of yours. And so, but you've also gotten to work on other shows with all these pre-established characters. So is it a bit more freedom because you can basically decide, because no one's going to message you saying this character would absolutely not say that, you know, it's so out of character. So is there a bit more freedom attested in that aspect?
Yeah, there's a lot more freedom. There is absolutely, and there's a lot more freedom, and not just with the characters, with everything. When you create a show, when you're running the show as a showrunner, you get to pick things like the houses they live in, the cars they drive, the clothes they wear, like all that thing. You're involved in the casting, you know, so you have complete control over well, not complete. You will, but you a lot of saying in various aspects of the show. So it is really kind of like, there's a lot of freedom in that. There's a lot of freedom to kind of to do what you want to do, and that leader succeed or it'll fail, and then it'll all be on you. Kind of, and when you're working on other shows, you come in, like I've worked on lots of shows under different showrunners. Like I worked on The Last Kingdom, I worked on Around the World in 80 Days, which will be out at Christmas. I worked on an Australian show called The Gloaming with a friend of mine who's a showrunner. In those shows, my duty is to go in and serve their vision. So I kind of, I have meetings with them. I know what they want from the characters. They'll talk about their show to me and what their intentions are and what they want, and we'll discuss story and all that. But my job at the end of the day is to give them their show. Like, they don't want, you know, me to come in and do some kind of crazy thing that's all mine. And they want me to present their show to them, you know, but kind of written in my voice a bit. So it is completely different. And you have different obligations, and, you know, and I know that. Like, so when I take a job writing on a show, which I like doing, like I enjoy that sometimes. I enjoy the lack of responsibility. Like, I enjoy that I just have to come in, write my episode. I don't have to worry about casting. I don't have to worry about, like, you know, whether people are going to love it or not love it. Like, it's just, you're doing a job that you enjoy. Like, show I worked on recently that I really loved working on was called The Last Kingdom. It was on BBC, yeah. And then it's on Netflix. I would have done another season of Kin, I haven't gone into production. I was in the writer's room I can't remember season 4, and I was in the writer's room, or 3, and I was in the writer's room for the next one. And I kind of, like, that was a brilliant show. It was like, we had a great showrunner who I really liked, a woman called Marta Hillier. It was a kind of a project I liked. I enjoyed doing it. And it was just great fun. It was really, really great fun. And there's something kind of nice about that. With this, there's more pressure. There's more angst, because, like, for every good review, there's people going, this is terrible. And you have to take all that on board and do all that. So it's a completely different kind of, but if you want to write as a writer and as a TV writer, you want to make your own TV shows. You want to see your ideas up on the screen. So, yeah. You know, and that's there's upsides and downsides. But at the end of the day, this is why I became a writer, was to make up worlds and characters and see them on TV and watch loads of people watching it and hope they like it. So,
yeah, definitely. And so if anyone's looking to get into writing, what advice would you have for them just before you finish up?
I don't really know how to answer that. Like,
get an RTE show? Is it just that? Just go.
Yeah, look, I'm at it a long time. Like, when you say get into writing, what do you mean? Like
as a writer, if anyone was looking, you know, to get into script writing or anything like that, what advice would you give them just for starting out?
Well, I would say write. Like, just like you have, like, there is no shortcut to it. There is no, like, you have to write. And like, I'm at it 25 years. I've had my own shows. I've had 2 shows in the last 5-6 years. So I spent 19 years working on shows, working on things, developing ideas, like having a great time, but, like, you know, almost serving an apprenticeship, working under really good people who taught me loads. And that was really good. But, like, and it was really tough times in that. But, like, I never gave up. And I think a lot about what writing is and becoming a writer and the life of a writer. There's 2 different things. There's you as, like, the writing you do as a writer, which is, you know, your craft as a writer and your voice. Those things just come with practice and working at it and finding it yourself. And sometimes it's you finding it. Sometimes it's you finding the things you want to say, the things that make you feel passionate, the things you want to write about. So that comes through writing and reading. As I said, when I was starting out, when I was young, I read everything. I would say, if you want to write the TV, read TV scripts, pick the shows you love, read their scripts, read as much as you can and get a sense of how people who do it really well, you know, write. And then there's the second thing, is the life of being a writer, which,
yeah,
like, it can be good, but it's like, it can be really, really difficult. Like, I read a report, and I don't know how many years ago, it could be 5 years ago, but it was done by the Screenwriters Guild of Ireland, saying, like, and I can't remember the exact figures, but it was something like 85% of writers in Ireland were making less than 15,000 a year. Now, that's me pulling it from my memory. That could be way off, but what it was a lot of writers were making very, very little, and these were professional writers, and it's a really hard job, and it's really hard to keep going. And a lot of being a writer is being told no. Like, for every show you get, like, you'd have had 20 or 30 kind of rejections on other shows or things that went some of the way. So, and I think what happened with me, and I can only speak for myself, is, like, I kept at it even through really, really bad times. I just kind of thought, like, this is what I am. Like, I can't imagine doing anything else. So I kept at it. And through perseverance and probably getting better by doing it and doing it and keeping at it, you know, I got to a place where things began to go very well for me. And in the last, say, maybe decade, I've had a kind of like a very kind of fulfilling career working on lots of shows I like, getting to create my own shows. But the build up to that was like, you know, I had to like many years, so many times where I'd sit down and go, I can't keep doing this. Like, how am I gonna pay the mortgage? How am I gonna do whatever? But I had a very supportive wife though. But I did keep at it, and I hope I got better as a writer.
Yeah.
And through perseverance and through just keeping at it, I got to a place where, you know, things are going well now. So that's I don't know, that's not much really. I don't have a magic bullet for you. Do you know what I mean? Do this one thing and you'll be successful.
And also get an RTE show, everyone. That's basically great advice. Peter, it's been such a pleasure talking to you. I know you have somewhere to be. So thank you so much for coming on. Please keep up the great work with Kin. You know, me, my dad, my mom, my sister, we've all been loving the show. It's been so fantastic. What better way to spend time with your family than watching Dublin people shoot each other? Before we finish up, is there anything you'd like to promote or talk about or anything like that? Kin, of course.
No. Maybe you're YouTube channel, like, well, everybody tune in, we'll watch Daniel's channel. I'm just chuffed you to have me on it. It was lovely to get your message. It's lovely to be on it, and keep watching Kin.
Thank you so much. It's been my absolute pleasure. I couldn't believe that you said everyone go check out Kin. It shows on RTEs every Sunday at 9:30, correct? 9:30 p.m. And it may be different over there in America, AMC. I'm not too sure about the time over there. Thank you guys so much for watching. They can check you out over on Twitter at Alder Bookthorn, correct?
At Alder Bookthorn, yes.
Yeah, that's on the description. Thank you guys so much for watching. Go watch Kin and, you know, just go spread the word of Fudge and Jimmy Snake, I guess, you know, whatever. Thank you guys so much for watching. Please make sure to like and subscribe. You can follow me over on Twitter at SamboGuzmo1. And as always, please make sure to donate to the National Deaf Children's Society. Link for that in the description. That's the NDCS @.uk. There'll be a link for all that on there. And if you have the means, please make sure to donate. But if not, that's completely fine. As always, thank you guys so much for watching. I will see you all in the next video. Go check out Kin. But thanks for watching. Stay safe. Bye.